The heat is on, but Beth will only let us turn it up to 50. Just kidding, it's a camera.
Stronger than the power.
you, our praise to you, our voice, our instruments. We ask that you be blessed by our efforts, by our praise, by our worship here this morning. We ask your anointing on the church, on the pastor as he preaches the word this morning, Lord. Heal the sick, comfort the lonely. Lord, we just ask you to be here with us today, Lord, in all we do. Good night. And then Dodgeball. Kim's getting serious. She's getting serious. We're going to start throwing objects at one another to raise money to replace the windows around. So, get a team together. Keep your trash talking to a minimum or just don't tell me about it. March 18th, well, we need to get teams together ahead of time. So we got a head count so we know what's going on. It's going to be at the YMCA, so you can wear safety glasses if you need to, whatever. But again, Iron Sharpens Iron is also going on. Is that the same day? March 18th? March 18th. So, you can sharpen your iron or throw the red ball, whichever thrills you, but there's something going on that day for you.
Praise the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. We're mindful of the goodness of God. Okay, I'm mindful of the goodness of God. Do you know that God's good?
Amen.
No, do you really know that God is good? Amen. We need to remember that if it was not for the Lord on our side, where would we be? If it wasn't for the love of God that has no end, where would we be? And so sometimes when we come to church, we come to church because we are churchgoers. We love the Lord. But we ought to come to church with an expectation of getting caught up in the presence of the living God. We ought to come to church with an expectation that God is going to move upon our behalf and meet us right where we live. We ought to come to church this morning with the ideal and the thought that He answers prayers, that He meets us, that He holds us, He keeps us. He's able to guide us and direct us. He will be our strength. We ought to come to church believing that I can place my impossibilities before a God where all things are possible. We ought to come to church to be an uplifter for the person sitting to your left or to your right, the one in front of you or behind you. We ought to come to church because we are the church. See, I believe this morning as we go to prayer that it's important that we begin to say, Lord, we're reaching out to you because why? The word tells us His arms are not short concerning us. He is reaching out to us no matter where we're at, the stage of life where we find ourselves. See, I understand as a Christian, we're not all that we're supposed to be. I understand as a Christian that I come short of the glory of God. I understand as a Christian that there's only one who is perfect and His name is Jesus. But I understand as a Christian that God is able to pick me up, turn me around, place my feet on solid ground, that as a Christian, that I can rise above my circumstances and situations. I understand that I'm weak, but in Him I am made strong. As a Christian, I can stand even when oppositions of life continue to come my way. I can stand. I had a sister say to me today, tears coming down her eyes, she said, my family's in trouble. My kids are looking at a divorce. The marriage is in trouble. But you know what we did? We just put that marriage in the hand of God. We put that marriage in the hand of God. I know what God is able to do. I know what He is able to do, capable of doing in our heart, in our lives, in our circumstances. And so we took that family before the one who is the creator of marriage. His name is Jesus. And so I don't know where you at this morning. We had a couple get married. We got another couple want to get married. And if you're single, come talk to me. I've been told I got a pretty good hookup. God is able. God is able. I was at the hospital yesterday, and Sarah Leffingwell was there, and she needs prayer. She bronchitis was really bad and stuff, and so we were there with her. Then I made a mistake. I went up to see Jack. I told him I said I only have 5 minutes. Half hour later, I got out of there. Jack is doing better. He said, "Did you hear the story?" So we know Jack is doing better. This is a great day. I came down this line with Ming's kids and was some high-fived me. Some tried to squeeze my hand till I dropped. I saw all kind of love this morning. All kind of love. See, this is what we're about. And so this morning, and I don't know where you're at, but I just know that Jesus is the answer. Some have doctor's appointments coming up, and they may be serious. Jesus is still the answer. You may be dealing with your job situation, but Jesus is still the answer. I know that we got some health issues going on, but Jesus is the answer. And see, that's what we need to know this morning as we go to prayer. Jesus is the answer. And so I want you to reach out to him this morning because his arms are not short. He's reaching out to you. Father, we come this morning and we thank you, Lord, for this is the day that you have made and we rejoice and we are glad in it. We thank you, Lord, for waking us up and starting us on our way, Lord. We woke up in the right mind and our mind, Lord, was fixed on you, reminding us, Lord, hallelujah, that you love us. And that what goes on in us matters to you. But Lord, this morning we come to praise you, to tell you, Lord, what matters to you matters to us. Lord, we come this morning to tell you, Lord, we love you because you loved us first, Lord. We come this morning, Lord, to rejoice at the mentioning of your name. We come, Lord, to lift up praise and worship to you, Lord. We come this morning, Lord, to preach your word, Lord, and teach your word, Lord, because, Lord, your word is worship, Lord. Your word is life to us, Lord. We come this morning, Lord, thanking you. For you are a mighty God, Lord, worthy of all praise and honor and glory. Lord, I know there are people today, Lord, that are in this nation wondering what was going to happen, Lord, on that day of inauguration when Mr. Trump becomes the president of the United States. Lord, we need to remember, Lord, no one sits in office, Lord, unless you allow it. For all governments rest on your shoulders. Lord, you're the head of everything, Lord, and we come to you this morning. And Lord, we lift up America, Lord, because it has nothing to do with the president, Lord. America needs Jesus. We need you, Lord. And I pray this morning, Lord, that the word is going out, Lord. People are hearing that we are saints of God, children of God, called to your purpose. And Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, that we will be a mouth sounding, Lord, in the silence and the noise of the world, that Jesus is the answer. Lord, and so I pray today, Lord, for Mr. Trump, all them, Lord, that have been elected, Lord, all those that are coming in as his cabinet, Lord, I pray for them this morning. I pray, Lord, that they will recognize, Lord, that the ills of America are too big for any man or woman. America needs Jesus. And so, Lord, I pray today that we will begin to unite across this nation, north, south, east, and the west, Lord, to call on you, Lord, to bring forth peace. And then, Lord, I pray for our cities, Lord, in this county, Lord. I pray today, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that Canton and Lewistown, Farmington, Lord, the areas that are represented, Lord, Miller Grove, Lord, wherever that's at, Lord, we just pray this morning. Pray this morning, Lord, that as you're linking us together, Lord, that we would understand, Lord, that you're causing a great thing to happen. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, that we would begin to believe, Lord, hallelujah, that our sons and daughters are going to become children of God, that they will become lovers of God. We got families, Lord, sons and daughters, Lord, that go to church, but they're not about the church. Lord, we're praying for heart changes. And we're believing, Lord, that our children, Lord, will be sitting with us, Lord. Our grandchildren will be sitting with us, Lord. Our great-grandchildren will be sitting with us, oh God, praising the name of Jesus. And so, Lord, there's work to be done. We are saying, Lord, here are we. Send us, Lord, for the work of the kingdom. And so, Lord, we're believing today, Lord, for those that are sick and afflicted, those that are on our prayer concerning this, Lord, we lift them up to you this morning. We pray, Lord, that you would touch and meet them, Lord, right where they live. And then, Lord, we pray for the saints, Lord, that are visiting them, that your anointing would be upon them, Lord, in such a mighty way. Now, Lord, even when they walk into the place, the atmosphere will begin to change because they're coming in with you. Oh, Lord, let us believe this morning for great things for the kingdom of God. Pour out your presence, Lord, upon us, in us, that we might walk, Lord, in the truth and the liberty of you. And so Jesus, have your way. There's much concerns, Lord. A lot of things going on. Lord, and I pray, Lord, that these things would be instruments, Lord, whether it be the dodgeball or the concert, Lord, at the high school, that we'll invite a friend, somebody, Lord, who doesn't know, that we can tell them about the good news of Jesus. And so, Lord, we ask that you would have your way this morning. Minister to us as only you can. To the prayer that has been, the prayer request has been asked, or the one, Lord, that's been kept in silent, you know. We pray this morning, Lord, that you would move mightily, that your glory may be revealed. In Jesus' name we pray. Let every heart say amen.
Amen.
Let's give the Lord praise this morning. I want to warm you up one more time. I want to ask you to give the Lord praise this morning. Amen. Say, because I know how you're going to act at the hockey game. I know how you're going to act when your team is out there playing dodgeball. I've seen some of you at the baseball game. I know how you act. Church is not the place to get silent. Church is the place where we celebrate the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. As we prepare our hearts for the offering, I want to remind you of the importance of retired ministers and missionaries and their spouses. We're going to be taking up the offering on January the 22nd. We're going to begin to see some things and concerning that ministry. But we're asking that we be mindful for them that have labored hard for the kingdom of God, that in their time of need, that we would meet them where they're living, that we would encourage them. We read in the Bible where the widowers, rich and widowers, were needing bread and the importance of having those that would go and minister to them. We don't want to forget them who have labored for our sake. I'm sure that there is somebody that has been here at First Baptist at one time who's now retired. And maybe he just needs to be reminded that they are loved, and we thank God for the service that they have brought to us at such a time as this. And so on the 22nd, we'll be taking up the offering. And the goal that we're hoping for is that we will raise $500 for that offering. And so be prayerful, be mindful. That's coming up in 2 weeks. And so we're just believing God that we're going to be cheerful givers. We're going to respond in a way that we will further the kingdom of God. Because I'm learning now, as I turn 66, if I see it, I'll get that first check next Wednesday. Praise God. God is good. God is good. But there may be others that are needing that help as well. So let us be mindful as we give. This morning, as you reach for your tithes and offering, the Word of God says that we ought to be cheerful givers. So when you're putting your offering, your tithe in the plate, I need you to smile at that usher. So that they understand they're part of it and they're not the enemy. The goodness of God, the opportunity to give, is worship to the Lord. And so, gentlemen, as you would come and wait upon us now. We pray this morning, Lord, that you would take the tithe and the offering and use it for the furtherance of your kingdom. We pray, Lord, that lives would be touched and lives would be transformed. That we wouldn't just be giving for the sake of giving and helping for the sake of helping. But, Lord, that you might be revealed to all mankind. Rather here, Lord, throughout this nation or across the city. Lord, we want to see your kingdom come. And we want to give you all praise and glory. And so bless together. And we give you praise now in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Chota-san.
Come on, right. See if you can get it in there. mean, there's just a little bit. Let's just
two.
Okay, put it back in there. Okay, come on. Come on, get it in there. Why are you laughing?
Put the microphone to her. Say it again.
I can't.
She can't get it back in there. Okay. If you all try, I don't think we could get it back in there. Can you? Thank you, volunteers, for helping. Okay. We could stab it open. Oh, no. No knives in church. Not right. Oh, with the back of the... No, no. Well, then it... No. It won't go back in there. You know what? Our mouth is like that tube of toothpaste. Sometimes stuff that comes out is not so good. We might say a bad word. Or we might say something bad about somebody else. Oh, thank you for the lid. Okay. But once that is out, once that toothpaste is out of that tube, it's probably not going back in, is it? Even if we stab it and do all that. It's probably not going to. And that's how our words are. So when you think about what you're going to say or what you're going to, if you're angry, hey, listen. I don't know if he's still working on how to get back in. Okay. But once it comes out of our mouth, we can't rewind and go back and not say that, can we? Because once it comes out of our mouth, it's out. Right? And the only thing we can do when we say a bad word, when we say something bad about somebody, when we're not loving and sweet like Jesus, we can't get those words and put them back in our mouth and our voice box, can we? So the only thing we can do is, say I said a bad thing about you that wasn't even true. What can I do to get those words back? Say sorry, she said. Yes. So, remember this tube of toothpaste. When you get ready to say something bad, don't do it. Think about that, because you can't get those bad words back and unsay them, right? Okay, and ask yourself, is what I'm getting ready to say, would that sound like something Jesus would say? Or does he want me to really say that?
No.
Okay? Right. So when you think about the toothpaste and not let anything come back, come out of your mouth that you want to take back. Okay? All right? How many is going to do that? Is everybody going to do that? Think about it before we say something bad and ask Jesus if that's the right thing to say.
Get your hands up.
Yeah. There you go. There you go. Look back there. They raised their hands too. Because it's hard to get it back. And if I tell him, I'm sorry I said that bad thing to you, and he'll say, okay, I forgive you. But he's going to kind of remember. You'll forgive me, but he'll remember I said. Okay? So we're going to try to do that. Just like good things come out of our mouth. Because we can't. There's the message, right?
Yeah.
Okay. If good things, hey, come here, Sean. Tell everybody that.
If you say something good, you don't need to put it back because it's good, not bad.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
You don't need to put it back. You got it, brother. You got it. Yeah. Out of the words, out of the mouth of children. Praise God. Thank you for that. Let's all say a prayer, and then you're going to go to Junior Church, okay, and have more fun and learn about the one who loves us and wants us to just say good things to people, right? Okay, dear Lord, thank you so much for these children. Thank you for this lesson about we need to watch what comes out of our mouth, Lord, because we can't take it back once it's out. And Lord, the only thing we can do is ask for your forgiveness and for their forgiveness.
Bless us as we go to junior church. Lord, that we can, these children can learn more about you, and as Pastor Clint brings your word that you've given him to us, may we receive it with open hearts and minds. In the name of Jesus. And all the people said,
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
This is the time that we prepare our heart to take what we call the Lord's Supper. One of the two ordinances that we practice here at First Baptist Church, that and baptism. The Word of God reminds us of the promises that Jesus made on the night that he was captured and was arrested. And the work of Christ that he fulfilled for the reason that he came. So communion is important to us. And so as we gather today, I pray that your hearts would be in that place where God can speak to us, that we understand the forgiveness of sin and the love of God that has no end for our lives. The word in 1 Corinthians 11 says to us, "The teaching I gave you, the same teaching I received from the Lord. On the night when the Lord Jesus was handed over to be killed, he took bread and he gave thanks." Let us pray.
Thank you.
tells us that when the hour came, Jesus with the apostles, they reclined at the table. But he said to them, I eagerly desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say I will not eat again until it's fulfilled in the kingdom of God. He said that he took the bread and he broke it and he gave thanks for it. And he said to them, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us eat. Again, we find in the Word of God that on the night that Jesus was handed over to be killed, that he took the cup and he prayed. And now we give thanks for the cup of blessing that symbolizes the blood of Christ.
Father, we thank you for the shed blood that allows us to have redemption and restoration to you, and we ask you to bless this cup in Jesus' name.
Until the kingdom of God comes. And in the same manner, Jesus took the cup. This cup is a new covenant, a new testament in my blood, which is poured out for you. And when you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. Let us drink. Child or young person. Many of us have that same story when it was that time of communion and watching the saints take of the cup and bread. And we're not as strict here as we were back in the day, but communion really is only for believers. It's only for them who know Christ. We need to understand that Jesus said, I did this for you. And it's an importance for us to know that Christ did this for me. I need you to say that. Christ did that for me. See, because sometimes we forget. We think about that other person. I know that he had to die for you. You're a mess. But it didn't matter where you came from. You are. Even Mary needed a Savior. And so we celebrate this time of God's great love for us, that He sent His only Son to die for us. And so as we look at the Word of God this morning, as out of Mark chapter 3, verses 31 through 35, I ask that you stand for the reading of the Word. And let us read the Word of God together. Ready? Read. Then his brothers came and his mother came, and standing outside they sent to him, calling him. And the multitude was sitting around him, and they said to him, Look, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. But he answered them, saying, Who is my mother or my brothers? And he looked around in a circle at those who sat about him, and said, Here is my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God is my brother and my sister and mother. Father, we thank you right now, Lord, that you had a plan from the beginning when you said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. You knew what we would go through, Lord, and you prepared a way through Jesus Christ, your Son. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, as we understand your love for us, that we would understand today, Lord, the call of this great salvation you have given us. As we've taken, Lord, the bread that represented your body that was broken for us, the juice that represented your blood that was shed for us for the remission of sin. Lord, open up our understanding today of this great love you have for us. We ask this now, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Last week we shared that we were looking at the theme for this year, to know and to do the will of God. And I know that we say that that is something that a child of God should understand. But I remember my parents echoing the same words over and over and over again to me. And sometimes I looked at them and I see the frustration in their face because they're thinking, how many times do I have to tell you not to do this? And a lot of times when they were telling me something, I would say to them, I know. But evidently I didn't, or they wouldn't have to continue to repeat these things over to me again. Now, maybe you weren't like me. Maybe you were that perfect child. See, I know what that is like. I had three that weren't perfect. Gotcha. Perfect to me. But we know that here the Word of God is telling us that He is calling us to a place in relationship with Him. And that He wants us to know His will as we live our lives as children of God. And he wants us to understand our purpose. And so last week, as we began to look at the Word, we talked about how that Jesus shared to with the disciples in John chapter 4, that he said to them, look, the wheat is white, ready for harvest. He was letting them know that people were hearing the good news and they were ready, their hearts were ready to receive Christ as their Savior. He let them know that the food that he desired was to do the will of the Father. And that word is a word of encouragement to us that we should be desiring to do what? The will of the Father. Now, I don't know about you, but as a young Christian, I had trouble understanding what the will of the Father was. I thought the will of the Father was for me to try to be a good little boy, to mind my mother and father, try not to pick on my sister, or all of those little things, you know, not get in trouble, and to get good grades. Okay, I picked on my sister, I didn't get good grades, I didn't mind my mother and father, but I love the Lord. Wait a minute. I'm a child of God, and I'm still messing up. I was in church, and what they told me was that you need to do better. You said you love Jesus. But what I'm telling you this morning is that until you understand what the will of the Father is for our lives, you will operate in your own understanding and your own likeness. You'll understand in your own strength and your own ability. And in some things, you will do very, very well. And then there's that one thing that you continue to trip up over. And so, what is he saying? My meat is to do the will of the Father. What he was saying is that I'm going to live my life for the call that God had placed upon him as the Savior of the world. That baby born in a manger came for one reason. His name was Jesus. He came to save. And it sounds really good, except that to save us, he had to go up to the cross. He was beaten and bruised for our transgressions. His body was ripped to shreds. His blood was shed for us. When we take communion, sometimes we forget about the suffering Christ went through that we might know the will of the Father. I said to you earlier, I said that communion sometimes, that we're sometimes laxed on it. But I know that communion is really meant for the saints. But I believe that sometimes we need to have our children understand why we're doing what we're doing. That they need to understand what Christ went through for us and then the call of that salvation that is for us. We have shared how that Paul talked about that I want to know him, the power of his resurrection. That what he was saying is that I want to know how to do the will that God has placed upon my life. Have you ever struggled with that? Have you ever struggled with trying to please God? Trying to be that good little boy that that good man, that good woman. Haven't you struggled in trying to be everything that God would have you to be? I've talked to many over the years, and a lot of times men will say to me, I just don't get it. I don't get it. I read, I don't get it. I'm trying, I don't get it. I just keep messing, I don't get it. But what we need to understand to get it is that we have to come to a place of understanding. There's nothing in me that will ever be able to do the will of God except that Christ be in me. So the will of God that we look at in Scripture that begins to tell us that God has a plan for each and every one of us and that how we are to live our lives out in Him. Jesus and Mark, we find that in Mark's teaching, that the Word of God says that he was there and he was speaking to the leaders of the synagogue and he was telling them and talking to them. And we read about how that at 12 years old, he was asking questions of them. And then they were amazed at the answers. Now he's older, he's 30 years old, and he's sharing with them. And if he amazed them at 12, you know he's blowing their mind now. And he comes in and they come to him and they says, Jesus, your mother Mary is out there, your brother James and Jude, they're out there. And they want to see you. And Jesus looks at them and he says, these disciples, these that are gathering around me, these are. those who do my will, do the will of my Father, do the will of God, those are my brother, my sister, and my mother. Jesus begins to let us know that if you're not connected with God, you'll never be able to do the will of God. You'll be able to do good things. There's a lot of good things done that are important things that help many people, but they will not be classified as the will of God. See, you've done some good things, and you've not done them necessarily because, well, that's the will of God for my life to do. I saw somebody with a flat tire, went over to help them, and this and that and the other, and I says, God ought to give me some points for this because, why, it's cold out here, and this and that and the other. I told him, go set still. I got this. My fingers are freezing. Surely I ought to get some extra points for that. No, it's not about doing nice things. It's about being obedient to the things of God, which might be nice things to other people. But we need to understand that just because people do nice things, they're not doing the will of God. See, because the Bible even says that heathens do nice things. See, even before I knew how to honor my mother and father, my mother and father trained me to honor them. They spoke to me where I could understand. And I learned. Now, I'm going to upset some of you. They taught me how to say yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am. And then I taught my children how to say yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am. And I remember a deacon saying to me one day, he says, man, people don't do that anymore. Kids don't have to say yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am. And I said to him, well, you raise yours the way you want to. But in my house, we're going to learn how to respect. And so when your children say to you, those of you who have small children, that I called Mrs. So-and-so by their first name and Pastor grabbed me and said, you'll call her Miss So-and-so, but you won't call her by her first name. Don't be upset. Don't be upset because why? Children need to know how to honor them that are older. Give them respect. Now, it may not be your philosophy, but I'll help educate you as you continue to stay here. Amen. Doing the will of the Father. So important for us as we go into this new year, because everything will change for us as we begin to embrace the thought and the idea that I am going to do and live to do the Father's will. To do that, first of all, Jesus tells us that there was a reason that he came. He came that none should perish, but all should have eternal life in Christ Jesus. That there was a reason that he came. Jesus was the ransom. For this reason, I was born, he says in John 18. Pilate asked him the question, am I a Jew? Your own nation, Jesus, the chief priests have delivered you into my hands. What have you done? And Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. And if my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. And Pilate therefore said to him, are you a king then, or are you not? And Jesus said, you said rightly that I am a king. And for this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. And Pilate said to him, what is truth? When he had said this, he went out again to the Jews and said to them, I find no fault in him at all. What is truth? Jesus. Jesus is the truth. We're living in a day where people are saying that truth is depending upon how I feel. You might call it an orange, but I'm going to call it an apricot. Because why? I like apricots, I don't like oranges. So to me, that's not an orange, that is this. Now we think that's still foolish. But we struggle with to abort or not to abort the unborn. To me, it seems pretty simple. Murder's murder. Whether in the womb or outside the womb, murder's murder. And if a child of God understands that Jesus is the giver of life, God is the giver of life, then there is no such thing as a pregnancy that is a mistake. Some of you may have been called an oops. But the truth of it is, there is no such thing as an oops. God is the giver of life. And if he is the giver of life, then no one has the right to take away what God had given. See, what I'm telling you is that if we're going to abide in his will, it's not going to be an easy road for us to travel in. We're going to be able to, going to have to understand why we believe what we believe and why we stand the way we stand. We're going to be challenged in our walk because why? The question is, what is truth? And for the child of God, truth is to do the will of the Father according to the word of Scripture, to what God's word has spoken to our hearts and into our lives. Now, I prayed about this. I prayed about this thing before we spoke it last week. I prayed about it because why? I said, Lord, it's hard being a Christian. And if we start to tell people that if they want the best of God, they got to line up with the will of God, people are going to say that's hard. But then the Lord reminded me, how easy was sin? I'm going to tell you, sin kicked me upside one street and down the other. Sin would even let me think I was getting away with something and snatched the rug out from under me. And then sin would reach down and pick me up. And then brush all the dirt off of me and tell me to get back at it and then trip me up again. I don't know about you, but sin has been hard. Sin has been hard. Sin caused life to be difficult for me. My parents spent a lot of time trying to beat the sin out of me. That meant I was in trouble all the time. Sin is hard. Sin is a yoke that is wrapped around you that wears you out. Takes away all your joy. There is no peace. There is no comfort in it. Sin is tough. And I want to remind you of that so that when you begin to look at desiring to do the will of God, to abide in him, to be part of his family, that you will not be so easy to throw in the towel because you remember just how hard sin has been. Jesus told Pilate that he was the king of the Jews. And Pilate did come up with the truth. He found no fault in Jesus. He may not have been able to embrace it, did not understand it, but he knew that they did not have a case against him because how are you going to arrest a man for raising the dead? Opening the eyes of the blind, causing the lame to walk. How are you going to fault somebody from doing those kind of things? Even they said, you must be from God because no man can do these things. All I'm saying is that as we look this year as going into what the Word of God says for us, how to abide in the will of God, we need to know that you only can do this if you are born again. The will of God cannot be done by sinners, by the world. In fact, anytime there's a catastrophe in the world, the first people to show up are the saints of God. They don't worry about cost. They don't worry about how long it's going to take. They're there from start to finish. In fact, in many cases, if it wasn't for the saints of God, those that are destitute would remain destitute because it's the children of God that go first into those situations. Governments are trying to get together and find out what they legally can do and what we're going to do and how much we're going to do. But the saints of God just says, let's go do it. And they get up and go into those hard conditions that the light might be seen. Jesus came to be a ransom. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. The reason we need a ransom to pay our debts is because we were born in sin. It's a debt that we could not pay. Jesus is the only one that was able to pay it. And so first of all, for us to learn the will of God, we have to know that there had to be a price paid for us. That Jesus came and died for us. He wants us to know him. To have a relationship with him. And so when he said, my brother, my sister, who are they? Those are those who trust me, hear me, and begin to do what I called you to do. Jesus came to call the sinner to repentance, to have a changed heart, to understand that where I'm headed by myself, I'll never get to where I want to go, and that I have to ask Christ to come into my life and forgive me of my sin. And so he came that man might understand that he needed a Savior. That he needed a Savior. When you're young, sometimes you don't necessarily realize you need a Savior. And then there's that age period there that you realize that you need some help, but we're too young to understand, to reach out to get it. And then we get to another age there that we have done so many things on our own, we don't need nothing because why? I'm my own strength. I'm telling you, if you live long enough, you'll begin to understand you can't fix it. You can't turn it around. You can't change things. You need a Savior. And so the Word of God tells us that we need to repent, that we need to have a change of heart, that we need to come to understand the call of God that is on our life. Jesus came that he might what? Give sight to the blind. Not physical sight, but he came that we would have a moral sight to the blind. We are told that the woman, Roe v. Wade, where that decision was made, years later became a Christian. And that was blind. Now sees. She is out there today and she's promoting Save the Unborn. She thought in her blindness that she had a right and this life was hers to do whatever she wanted to do. But then she met a Savior. And he opened up her blind eyes. The light came in. She was blind, but now she saw. See, we need to understand that's what he's there for. That when we see people walking in blindness in the foolishness of life, we need to begin to pray for them. We can tell them that they're blind, but sometimes you don't know that you're blind. See, a blind person, if they lay out their own room, you know what they are able to do? They can walk through that room. They know where everything is at. They know how many steps it takes to get to it. You can stand in that same room, close your eyes. Guess what you're going to do? Blind learn how to operate in their blindness. But when Christ comes into their life, they realize just how blind they were. Do you remember when Christ became real to you and you realized just how lost you really were? That's what it's about. So he came that he might heal the eyes of the blind. That we would come into the light, for Jesus is the light of the world, and whoever believes in him will not remain in darkness. He did not just come to pay the ransom. But he wanted to open up the eyes that we might walk in the light that is in Christ Jesus. Jesus came to stir things up. In Matthew chapter 10, it tells us that he came to bring peace on earth. And Jesus said, no, he didn't. Now we say peace on earth. Jesus said, I did not come to bring peace on earth. I have not come to bring peace, but I came to bring a sword. I have come to set man against father, and daughter against her mother, and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foe will be those in his own household. Jesus is saying that when I come into your life, I disrupt things. Somehow, old friends don't want to be bothered with you when you got Christ in your life. Your children begin to don't want to be around you because mama, daddy, all you want to do is talk about Jesus. You want to tell them about how good God has been. They get tired of hearing it. In fact, I was talking to a mom not too long ago. She said, my kids aren't open to hearing it. They said, Mom, we don't want to hear that stuff. And I said to her, all right, then don't preach to them for an hour. Just tell them, give me 5 minutes. Just give me 5 minutes. In 5 minutes, I'm going to tell you why I love Jesus. And Jesus says, I stir up things. Because why? When the light comes in, people begin to recognize that you're not the person that you used to be. And Jesus came to save and to bring us out of the condemnation that life has brought upon us. Some of us have a past. And people cannot embrace us because why? They continue to remember our past. But Jesus is bringing us out of that condemnation. Because I am not who people say that I am. I'm not who I say that I am. But I am who Christ says that I am. He wants to set us free from the things that our past has heaped upon us and told us that we're not good because of this happening and that happening in our lives. He comes to set us free. All I'm saying is that if we desire to do the will of Him, we first have to know Him. And then we have to know that when we have Him in our lives, these are the things that He is able to do for us. He's able to set us free. He's able to forgive us of our sins. He's able to open up the blindness in our eyes. He's able to set us free from the condemnation that life brings to us. God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through Him that the world might be saved. He who believes in Him is not condemned, but he who does not believe in Him is condemned already. God sent His Son to save us from His own just condemnation and wrath. And Jesus came because why? I'm already guilty. I'm already guilty of all of the worst sins of the world because I'm born in sin. I'm capable of doing all the worst things because I'm born in sin. And Jesus did not come to condemn me because why? I'm already guilty. He came to save. It's important that I understand that and you understand it because why? Sometimes we're trying to convince people that they're not good enough. But the truth of it is that we just let them understand you're born in sin. And that's why you need a Savior. Because they will begin to compare themselves to you. Okay, to me. I begin to tell them why they need a Savior. And they'll say to me, Money, my life never was as bad as yours. I understand why you needed a Savior. And Frank. Thought I was going to forget you. Dale. Ben. Dion. I know he's a good old man now. But Dale, you needed a Savior. See, what I'm saying is that we're all born in sin. We were condemned already to go to hell. Death was upon us, and the only way that our lives would change would be through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so when we begin to say that we want to line our lives up, to begin to understand the call of God upon our lives, and we desire to know the will of God for our lives, we have to come to a place of saying, I'm a sinner. And it's only by Christ that I can be saved. So the example that we've used so many times is the baby. We told you last week, house warm, diaper change, belly full. And that rascal wants you to hold them. Lay them down, they cry, you pick them up, they stop. Lay them down, they cry, you pick them up. And then you lay them down and you start to walk away. They let you get 3 steps because they hear you and then they cry again. And if you come back and they're almost chuckling. They're wicked. They need a Savior. See, that lets us know just that you didn't have to teach your baby how to be bad. The baby already knew how to be bad. Knew how to be selfish. Go down to the nursery when they got the toys out. One child got all the toys and the rest of the kids just standing there looking. We're selfish. We know the word mine and we know the word no. And no parent has to teach their child to be bad because they get it from, and you decide which one of the parents they get it from. But he came to give eternal life. See, when I was looking at the text, I've been looking at this to do the will of the Father. I wanted us to know that, first of all, we have to be born again. We have to receive Christ as our personal Savior forever, desiring to do the will of the Father. Jesus said, my meat is to do the will of God. And my question this morning is, what are you eating? Are you eating the Word of God and applying it to your life? I went away Wednesday and Thursday. Then we came back Friday and we had the dinner at the restaurant. And then I came to the men's breakfast yesterday and they had all this food and these cinnamon rolls that were off the chart. And I got on the scale this morning. And I ate so many things that were wrong. If you feel right here, Dottie, you can feel three cinnamons. I didn't want to say no. She said I couldn't say no. I did not want to say no. I ate two there, and then I told Tyler to put four back for me. Put them back for me. But it's the Word of God that we begin to eat, that our lives begin to change. When I'm eating right with the things of God, the heaviness of the world begins to drop off of me. When I'm desiring to do the will of Him who has called me, the heaviness of the world begins to drop off of me. Jesus in Scripture tells us that you that are heavy laden, burdened down with the cares of the world, you that are struggling, trying to make it in this life, He says, come unto me, for my yoke is easy and my burdens are light. He's saying to you, you that are yoked up to the world. See, as I told you earlier, as a Christian, I've been still hooked up with the world. I know that I'm born again, but Frank, I've been carrying some stuff of the world with me. As though it should be a lighter load. Jesus said, I'm carrying the load, but I'm dragging all this mess with me. And Jesus is saying, if you want to do this right, forgetting those things that are behind, He wants me to learn how to run after Him. That He's learned teaching me how to forget about all the stuff I'm not and begin to grab a hold of the things that I am in Christ Jesus. All of us have made mistakes. We could have done better. But I'm just telling you this morning that Jesus says that He is calling us to do the will of the Father. And you'll never be able to do the will of the Father if you're still hanging on to the cares of the world. Holding on to your past. Forgetting those things that are behind. They're behind us. So you've had some trouble along the way. So you've made some mistakes. And maybe you still are not the best you can be in Christ Jesus. But He is telling us now to get hooked up into Him. And this is what it looks like. Wives, have you ever tried to have a conversation with your husband when the game is on? Or something he's interested in doing, seeing is on. Have you ever been with him and tried, and he's going, okay. Now you're just asking him if you, it's all right that you could go out with the good looking man across the street there and stuff. He didn't care, he's watching the game. He wasn't paying no attention. You told him that I'm going to get that $100 out of your wallet because I saw some shoes I wanted. Is that okay? You don't pay no attention. What you have to say to him sometimes is, look at me. Turn it off. I saw you, Mike. My heart goes out to you, Kelly. Look at me. See, we get so caught up in the stuff, we miss out on the things that are important. Jesus has been saying, here I am. Read my words, spend time, and apply it to your life. But I get so caught up in the stuff that I forget all about Jesus. Now, I know that I'm saved, but because I'm not allowing the Word of God to live in me, Toddy, I trip and I fall. And I thank God I get up. If I don't run very far again, then I'm tripping and falling. So he says, if you're tired of tripping and falling, if you're tired of the stuff going on in your life, come unto me and rest. Rest. Get rid of the old baggage. Stop hanging on to the stuff. Let it go. Why are you still mad at him? He's been dead for 15 years. Let it go. So he's not the best father for your child. Let it go. You're the best mom that child can ever have. Let it go. If we desire to do the will of the Father, then we have to understand that I have to be connected to the things that he is calling me to. That he is my strength at the time of my weakness. That I can be that person that he's calling me to be. I can be better. And what I find out is that walking with Christ is so much easier than walking with the world. Or in my own thoughts and my own understanding. I said to you earlier, did you forget where you came from? Sin is tough. Sin is tough. It's hard. It beats you down. It wears you out. So that's why Jesus said, forgive. My yoke is easy. Forgive. Because what? They don't even know you're mad at them. And the one that's been dead for 15 years don't care. The only person getting upset is you. The will of the Father is that he wants us to understand that with him, the heaviness of the world can be dropped off. That we can do the will. That he can open up my blind eyes to the things that he is calling me to. That I can begin to understand what it is to have a wholeness in life that is only in Christ Jesus our Lord. Over the next several weeks, throughout the course of the year, we're going to see how Scripture lines up with the will of God, the call of God that's on our lives. That in every one of those circumstance situations that we'll look at in Scripture, we'll see that God's way is so much better. And that we'll begin to say, I know what my flesh is telling me, but my heart is saying it's time to do it God's way. My meat is to the will of the Father. When I do it right, there's nothing sweeter in this whole world than it is to be right with God. See, I'm tired of the heavy load. I'm tired of carrying my past around with me. I'm tired of tripping up over the same old things I tripped up over before. I want to get on about the Father's business. I want to know what his will is for my life. I want to apply all of his principles. So if I'm born again, it's time for me to line up with him. Mama, you got to trust God. God knows what that boy needs, and he'll be his strength. He will lead him to him. Because if he can save a sinner like me, surely he can save your son. Surely he can touch your daughter. Surely he can touch your wife. Surely he can touch your husband. Surely he can touch that neighbor. I have one of those neighbors. I would speak out, but somebody that's too close to me right now. Change has to come. And change only comes when you desire to do the will of the Father. That's when change comes. Only when I desire to do the will of the Father will change come. I'm born again. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away, and behold, I've become new. And spiritually, that's where we're all at. But unfortunately, some of the old things are dear and near to my heart. But God is saying it's time to let it go. It's time to shred it off. It's time to get free in Him. Because what the Word says, who the Son says free is what is free indeed. And so as we stand this morning to sing, Jesus loves me, I want you to understand and hear the words of it. Jesus loves me. If you've never received Christ as your personal Savior, you've not understood until the day that He died for you, took your sins upon Him, He bled for you, and His blood is the remission for your sins. It is that to pay your debt. He died the death you should have died. But He rose on the third day with all power in His hands to give life to all who put their trust in Him. If you're desiring this morning to know Him and the power of His resurrection, and you've never received Christ as your personal Savior, I'm going to ask that you come. But maybe you've been struggling and allowing the will of God to be done in your life. We will pray with you today. Maybe you've come and you desire to be a member of First Baptist Church. We invite you to come that we might receive you. And so as we sing this song, allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you this morning. Nisana, White Earth, has been coming for quite some time. But today she desired to become a member of First Baptist Church. Amen.
Amen.
She has women all around her where she lives that love the Lord, and they go here. And they've been encouragement to her, but she's also been a help to them. And she wants God, and we've taught, and she knows. And she knows, and she wants God. She's a good person, but she wants to give God a woman. A woman that will bring God glory and bring him honor. That's been the desire for her heart for such a long time. And then she has chosen to be part of the family of Christ here at First Baptist Church. Amen. It's your desire this morning to receive Anna as she goes through membership class and the things that need to be done, that she would have full membership here at First Baptist Church. Is your heart willing this morning and desiring that she become part of us? If so, just let me hear you say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now, Anna, I'm going to see that man there. Yeah. Oh, you don't know that man. She said Ray's really cool. It's okay, Anna. When you try to be, you come into a new family, you need to be nice. That's right. Ray will get with you and he'll tell you when membership classes start. You started. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Already started classes, she just wanted you to know that she's here. Let's stand to our feet to get you out of here. We're called into the righteousness of God. Jesus says, my will is to do the will of him who has sent me. The word of God tells us that he has sent us to go into all the world to preach the gospel, to be a light to others in the midst of darkness, to be encouragement that others might know the saving love of God that comes through Jesus Christ our Lord. And Jesus said his will, so our will should be to do the will of him who has called us and who has sent us. And so, Father, we pray this morning, Lord, that we will not be hearers only, but become doers of your word. Lord, I know that we struggle in this flesh, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, but let us press on to the righteousness that is in you. Your word is clear, Lord. You will help us where we're weak, Lord. You will strengthen us. And the man and woman who desires to do the will of the Father will never be put to shame. And so, Lord, I thank you today for your love that has no end. I thank you, Lord, for this great salvation. We thank you, Lord, that you are the Savior of the world. But Lord, you said, my family, my mother, my brother, my sisters are those who hear my word and then do it. And so, Lord, I pray for strength now that we will not be hearers only, but we will truly become doers of your word. Go with us, be with us now in Jesus' name. Let every heart say amen.
Amen.
Shake somebody's hand, tell them you're glad they're here today.
be here for a few minutes.